to the farmers. In fact, if you look at what's happening at a broader level, the Indian agricultural market scenario is changing. In fact, we find, if you take the per capita consumption of agricultural commodities, we find per capita consumption of food grains, etc., is on the decline. Per capita consumption of milk, meat, fish, fruits and vegetables on the increase. That means there is a demand shift. I just want to say, we have to produce what the market wants, and we will have to meet what the demands of the consumers. In this direction, I just want to say, there's a big transformation going on in the Indian agriculture sector. Suddenly, you go and ask any farmer, they're ready to produce, but the question they ask is, where to sell, when to sell, how to sell, so that they realize higher returns. And also the biggest problem faced by the farmer, the Indian farmers is, you just look at the very fact. They buy their commodities at the retail market where at a high prices. The retail prices are generally high. They sell their commodities in the mandis at the wholesale price. So imagine the kind of margin which never occurs to the farmers. In fact, the main thrust is how to bring this margin and reappropriate to the producers. This is the biggest challenge. That is where the market interventions, market support, and our value addition, etc. We have been talking since morning in a different sense. I'm very happy even Nimbalkar presented how market is important and marketing arrangements has to come in a different manner. Well, next one, please. Well, please, I just mentioned this. Well, I'm concentrating mainly on the fourth thing. I'm not going to elaborate because of the time. If you really look at the linking of the farmers to markets, one is the food processing and the food parks which people touched. This is very important. For example, the producers have backward integration so that the farmers produce are aggregated. For example, friends, these days all over the world, the aggregation model is working. Even if you see the Uber model or any commodity model, even in the agriculture, what the Reliance, etc., they have come into the retail. You know, they aggregate the commodities, and this is where the actual problem lies, because the aggregation involves, because you have to aggregate lot of diversified products which are not uniform. That's where the problem comes in. And when you take fruits and vegetable aggregation, there are so many fruits, there are so many vegetables. Aggregation is a big problem. That's what the processors face. And that's why they go for the backward integration so that they'll have the right material at the right time and at the right price. Then of course the organized retailing, and we have seen that some of the organized retailing, even people like Reliance, Big Basket, many organized players, even the cooperatives, for example, Dr. Mays was the managing director of the Hopcops, even a cooperative. For example, even in Maharashtra, the Maha Grapes, the Maha Mango are all very successful because you find lot of organized players and they supply to the organized retailers. Then the establishment of the National Agriculture Market, this was also touched, ENAM. Well, this is a very good move, but it will take long time. Because you may ask, why the agricultural commodities are not sold in the e-markets? You go to any of the Flipkart or Amazon.com, etc. Why the e-market in agricultural commodity doesn't work? Mainly because of two things. One, our agricultural commodities are not, with SA, that means there is no proper grading and standardization. For example, a person sitting at Delhi cannot put for rice sold in Bangalore because they are not SA, we use the right word. That means that the proper grades and standards, grade standards and the grading and sorting is not there. The second is, if you want you see the Amazon dot model, they aggregate, they distribute, and they have a proper warehouse system is there. There's a clear warehouse system. Without the proper warehousing, you cannot do the e-marketing. That's the major problem we find. E-norm, which has been started from the last 2 years. The e-norm is a very good concept. I have been a person associated with it in the beginning, and I see even this happens even after 10 years is a great success in this country. So that the markets all over the country is unified. So we will have a single market. It's a good dream. It's achievable. And with the ICT support given by the farmers are able to sell. For example, if you open up the Amazon.com, I see only Tilda rice is being sold. But if it happens, if you have a proper grade, and the consumers can you know, get the produce, you see the benefit that is reaching to the producers. The other one is the warehouse and the logistic parts. This is also an example. The great thing that has happened in this country is, you know, opening the warehouse to the private sector. That is a warehouse receipt, which is a negotiable instrument. You know, once you have the warehouse receipts, you can trade the commodities without physical exchange of the commodities. The warehouse is in the name of X, it can be transferred because it's treated as a negotiable instrument. But the problem is, it's not very popular among farmers. You know, only the traders are taking the benefit. Then of course the contract farming, we know the contract farming has been successful and highly successful in milk, and also great success in poultry. We have seen Subuna, Venkateshwar, etc. practicing very high level of vertical integration through contract farming. Why not more commodities? But you know, then the virtual markets. The virtual markets in this country is still yet to take off. That's why the agricultural markets, whatever ICT application, I would say the ICT application in agricultural marketing is very low. That's the very reason that our agricultural marketing, the access to market, and also the market is not really expanding. For example, if there's a commodity, you know, in the Nagpur market, it cannot be easily moved to the other markets where the prices are high, unless we have these arrangements. Next one, please. Well, friends, this is what I was just wanted to say. If you look at the dynamics of fast-changing agriculture food system, except the farm size, others are big. Only the farm size is, we have the average farm size in India is 1.53 hectares. But if you look at the aggregators, processors, etc., they are huge. Even if you see the warehouses, etc., the operation is big. It is but required. Without the scale, you cannot operate. Because your establishment cost will be very high. With the scale, the cost of operation will come down, the market will become efficient. The next one, please. Well, the food processing, next one, please. Of course, please go ahead, next one. Then go ahead. You know, for example, this is what I just want to say. See, for example, we find a lot of supermarkets coming in, what you call as the food retail chains. In fact, I had an opportunity to see, when I was working with the International Food Policy Research Institute, how this is emerging in about 8 countries. And we expected that these food retail chains to have backward integration of farmers, so that you know they create an alternative marketing channel, and because of the competition, the farmers get good price. But this is not really happening in India with us. Okay, sir, I'll end up. Please go ahead. No, that's why, friends, I just want to conclude. Come to the last slide. No, for example, go ahead. Well, friends, I just said how this, you know, for example, next, please. Well, friends, I gave some example of how the farmers can be linked to markets. In fact, in the 12th plan when we formulated, we just thought that the regulated market system in this country is not really working out. The Agricultural Produce Market Committee, what you call as the mandis, is really not working out. In fact, most of the studies have shown the total cost of marketing works to around 16%. So the thrust was to create alternate viable marketing channels so that the farmers can choose and the markets can be efficient and only, and all the benefits of this, you know, what the benefit fisheries are disciplined. We always say, for example, remove the middleman. It's a very foolish one. You cannot remove the middleman. Only you can, we must only discipline the middleman, because it's the middleman who expand the market. Farmers cannot. Well, friends, I just close saying that when you think about the linking of the farmers to the markets, where there are various alternatives, the system should be inclusive. What I say is, the small farmers should be part of the business model. Second is, there should be high level of competitiveness. When there are many players in the market, there will be fair amount of competition, which relay, when you know, for example, when there is a competition, the price and how it will be optimal. Third is, it should be sustainable model. For example, we have seen here and there it succeeds, but when you want to try out elsewhere, they are not sustainable due to many reasons, because the stakeholders involved do not have perfect understanding. The last one is, it should be scalable. We have seen in many places these models have succeeded, but they are not scalable due to many reasons, but it should be scalable. Thank you very much. Sorry, sir, I took.
Yeah. Thank you. This is flash of interest and the time. Sorry.
I call upon Dr. Vijayasuthan. Only because constraints.
Sustainability is very good afternoon. Good evening. I have been asked to speak on the strategies for ensuring food and nutrition security. Because of shortage of time, maybe I'll have to skip some of the slides, but I will try to convey the essential message in 8 to 10 minutes or so. The first slide, please. 8 minutes? Okay. Friends, let us see where do we stand today as regards agricultural production is concerned. Next slide, please. Yeah. You see, that's all. We are the largest producer of milk and the largest producer and consumer of pulses in the world. The figure 155 million tons is old one. Dr. Nanda says it is 166 million tons. We are also the second largest producer of many commodities. Food grains, fruits, vegetables, various other commodities. And this we have reached from a very low level. In 65, in 50, we were just producing 50 million tons of food grains. So 50 million tons to 275 million tons, the latest figure is 275 million tons. That will be a great jump. And also, we must not forget that we have only 4.2% of world's water and 2.4% of global land available. And we have to feed, or we are feeding 17% of the world human population and supporting 11% of world's livestock. So we are already doing a great job. And as I said in the last session, the last 50 years have been really a great accomplishment. Next one, please. This slide shows the food grain production from 50 million tons to 275 million tons. Next one. And can you go back? And you see the area from 19. So if you see, the area cultivated is 142 million tons, I mean million hectare, from 70 onwards. And the area has remained the same, production and productivity has gone up. Next one. If you see the food availability, food and availability, in 60-65 we were able to provide 450 grams or so, but at we were importing 10 million tons of food grain. Today, we have a per capita availability of 550 grams and we are exporting. We are not importing. Next one, please. Let's see what the situation in horticulture. The next slide shows you the situation there. Next one, please. There has been a great growth in horticulture productivity. Last year, we harvested 305 million tons of horticulture produce. In fact, for last 5 years, the horticulture production has surpassed the food grain production. That's indeed a great accomplishment. Next one. Milk production, I think Dr. Nanda has already spoken about it. Next one. So, let's summarize from food grains. In 50-51, from 50 million tons to 175 million tons, fruits and vegetables from 25 million tons, we have gone to 300 plus million tons. Milk 17 million tons to 166 million tons, eggs 1.8 billion to 90 billion, and fish from 75 million to 10.2 million ton. The average growth increase has been 4 to 20 times. Next one, please. What has been the region of success? If you see, there was a free flow of material and information both. Today, in the era of patent, nobody wants to spare his germplasm. Imagine if the dwarf varieties of wheat well rice were not shared by other countries, what would have happened to us, to our agriculture? Therefore, see the free flow of material and information, we need to find out how to ensure that still good materials we can get in and also we can send out. Adoption of high yield variety or modern variety and joint effort of polity, bureaucracy, scientific community and farmers. Okay, next one. There has been an unprecedented growth, increase in agriculture production, higher income growth, reduced poverty, life expectancy has increased. Next one. But, so we have been able to provide adequate quantity. When you look at quality today, what matters is how what we eat, not how much we eat. Next one. And because of that, there has been a malnutrition. If you see, almost around 40-45% of our school-going children are undernourished, malnourished. Next one. Every third child born in the country is underweight. So, the problem of malnutrition is really alarming. Next one. And this malnutrition is because of, one is calorie deprivation, second is protein deficiency, almost 70% of our population is protein deficient. And micronutrient deficiency, iron, zinc, vitamin A and folate. These are the major macronutrients which are required in very small quantity but not available. Next one please. Now, meeting protein requirement, what can we do? See, we are exporting soya meal with almost 50% of protein. And that will come out to be as if we are exporting 60 rupees per kg of protein. And we are importing pulses importing legumes with 20% protein, 75 rupees per kg. So we are exporting at 60 rupees per kg, we are importing at 75 rupees a kg. So why can't we make soya bean, why can't we make it available for the domestic consumption? There are various reasons for it, but I think it can be made possible. Around 16,000 crore rupees of the exporting. We should, okay, over? Okay, I'll try to finish up it. Next one please. So protein is that one. Next one. We have been working on developing crops. Where micronutrients are available and they can be, you know, you can see palm millet, orange soybean, orange sweet potato, then wheat, rice, lentil, maize and cauliflower. So we are trying to see that through biofortification and staple crops they can provide micronutrients. Next one. It has become so important that last year's World Food Prize was given to the person who has been heading the Harvest Plus, and he has been the force behind overcoming malnutrition. Next one, please. What are the challenges? So the current challenge is by 2050 we need to double the food production. Next one. Next one, please. And as I said, resources, we have limited land, limited water, and population is growing at alarming rate. Next one. Next one, I think this climate change is now we have been talking about so much. one more minute. Yeah, I think a couple of more will be there. Just go back. Okay. Go back. Yes. See, by 2020, if you see the middle column, you see, presently we are producing 109 million tons of rice. We need 120 million by 2020 and 180 million by 2050. And with the present level of knowledge and technology available, I don't see any problem. Similarly, wheat, there shouldn't be any problem. Coarse grain, there should be problem. Only pulses, there is a problem. And hopefully, we have already demonstrated in a couple of years that it can be, pulse production can be raised provided farmers get a right price, they get a remunerative price. vegetables, fruits, I think we are very comfortable, we should be able to meet the requirement. Next one, please. If you see the average productivity of the, you know, highest productivity at global level, we find that our productivity is almost half. So we have still 50%, you know, scope where we can increase the productivity. Next one, please.
Last one.
Okay, then I'll take next one. Then I will not take, go to the next one. Okay, what strategies to be adopted? You see, the new technology which is coming up, that has to be brought into a practice. You know about crop improvement, GM crops have been developed so much for taking care of diseases, insect, pest, all that, but we are not adopting. So, crop production, I think the nutrient use efficiency is just 50%. Can we increase it to 75%? That is what we need to do. Then crop protection, depending on the minimum use of pesticides, chemical pesticide. Transfer of technology is the biggest victim. And we need to improve that so that the technology which is generated can be to the farmers. Next one. I think that's the last one. Okay, can we feed India in 2050? This is the last slide. Okay, now we will need around 400 million tons or 450 million tons of food grains. We have irrigated area around 40 million hectare. Out of 40 million hectare, 35 million, if you take for food grain, we get around at 10 tons per hectare per year, we get 350 million tons. Rainfed area out of 65 million tons, if you take 35 million tons with 2 tons per hectare, 70 million tons. Dry land around 34 million hectare area, I'm not taking into account. So still we'll be able to, we'll have enough to feed. Next one, I think that's the conclusion is, 2/3 of India lives in villages and depends on agriculture. 9% growth in GDP can be supported only if agriculture grows at 4%. Higher agriculture growth can be ensured through agricultural education, investment in national agriculture extension and education system is very important, and the current conclave assumes great importance because we need to attract investment in agriculture R&D, agriculture education and agriculture extension, and we need to get private players to invest in this, and this can be done only through PPP mode. Friends, I think evergreen revolution is possible to ensure food and nutrition security if we really adopt the new technology and try to bring in more investment, try to bring in more technology and try to see that the technology is adopted. This is a picture of the greenhouse, tomato being grown. Here you can see the tomato all over around. Even at the top, sun sides. So this is a sort of vertical farming. So with these remarks, I thank the chairman for having given me opportunity to open up 4 minutes.
Thank you,
for kind extension.
Good evening, everybody. Party chair of the session. Yeah, dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, friends, young friends, students. The topic is enhancement of agriculture productivity and profitability through watersheds, bodies, and farmers producers organizations. The last one slide of Guptaji was technology for the rainfed areas. If you move in the villages, every farmer asks you, give us water, I will produce. But is it possible for you to give water to him? You can't think of irrigation for every acre of the country. That's why it is better that we adopt watershed technology to the rainfed areas. Though successfully watersheds have been implemented and shown
state governments are still not convinced of adopting this. Though integrated watershed management program was adopted by the government of India, they are yet to produce, they are yet to provide the funds for the projects sanctioned in the year 2009-10 and 10-11. This is the recommendation is that state governments must adopt this as a budgetary provision project. Everybody talks about budget for irrigation. Why don't you put what rainfed areas also on the same footing and provide the budget, state budget for watershed development in the rainfed areas? That should be the one of the recommendations. That's how, where we can improve the productivity of the rainfed areas and where the small and marginal farmers, millet growers, pulses, oilseed growers are there, their incomes can be improved. Similarly, though watershed projects are there, I would request the ICAR system and the agriculture university systems to study them and validate them, because they are now being done by implementing agencies who are not scientists, and validate that one and propagate through the Kisan channel and whatever other media is available to us so that it can go to the farmers. In Maharashtra, there is a Pani Foundation. Amir Khan started this after his Satyameva Jayate program success. He has been able to motivate people to voluntarily come forward and adopt watershed technology, and whereby people are able to improve the yields. Second aspect I was mentioning about the wadis. Wadi is a small orchard. They can be raised in rainfed areas where wadi farmer can continue to grow the crop, annual crop, what he was taking earlier, incorporating a locally suitable horticulture crop, and this field is surround, all around is protected by planted forest species. In the fourth year, orchard starts giving yield. Tremendous improvement in the farmer's income. Productivity of the land goes up like anything. This is the way we can think of increasing the yields of the farmers. This can also be taught in the agriculture college, horticulture college, forestry colleges. These wadis can be very easily implemented by convergence mode by all the state governments concerned. Horticulture department can supply the planting material, pack houses, fencing, micro irrigation. Forest department can give forest species for planting around the field. Under NAREGA program, pitting, trenching, all water conservation measures, farm ponds, everything, debris can be made. This is how we have tried this one in Raigad district of Chhattisgarh. Around 500 hectares we have sanctioned project. District administration has also sanctioned. We are implementing a big proposal of creating wadis in 25,000 acres with the convergence of the state government department's help and award is before the government of Chhattisgarh for consideration and sanction. Yes, sir. FPOs, whereas industry produces for the market, but not our farmers. Until and unless we orient our farmers to produce for the market, it is difficult. We are taught in college that you produce, you can market, but somehow our farmers are dependent on government for marketing. FAO is a system where farmers themselves create their own organization through which they market their produce. This has been shown with the help of Government of India, 200 crores since 1914-15. NABARD has assisted 2,200 farmers producer organizations in the country. Many other government programs under RKVY, and other programs, they have probably equal or more number of FEOs. These can be treated as pilots. ICR system and universities can study them, how these systems are working, can they be upscaled? Unless an FEO generates a business of around 15 to 20 crores, it may be very difficult for them to survive in the midst of middlemen and the vested interests. Just. Yes, yeah, I noticed. Since agriculture markets are not perfect and farmers are not able to get good price, everybody is looking to the government for MSP. Now, for the government, it should create large number of procuring centers. Unless they create that, it will be very difficult for the farmers to sell at the minimum support price. Now, can the farmer get MSP net of all the charges he is made to pay now? Commission, taxes, weightage laws, everything. Or whether we can bring a law prohibiting purchase of agriculture commodities less than MSP. Nobody, neither the private traders nor the government agencies should procure below MSP. Just like minimum wages act, bring it to the same footing and enforce it very strictly so that people, farmers can get better prices. There may be a hue and cry telling that it will lead to inflation. Many things happen. Everywhere, every policy, decisions, tax proposals create inflation. If it is creating inflation for giving better price to the farmer, why not we do it? Take the risk. Friends, production ke liye agriculture department, marketing ke liye, there should be on the equal footing agriculture marketing departments of the state governments. This is not happening. We are neglecting that one. This needs to be done. At present, APMCs are just managed by the marketing department. Why don't they promote FEOs then, farmer producer organizations? Go for processing units. Unless we are able to take out the labor at present dependent on agriculture, which is 47%, whereas contribution of GDP is 13%, I believe that percentage of people dependent on agriculture should be equal to the agriculture's contribution to GDP. If it is 13%, ideally in India, only 13% of the farmers' workforce should be in agriculture, not 47%. How to bring this one? Can we transform this agriculture, which is now human capital highly intensive, by bringing them, those people, out of agriculture, but manufacturing is not there to support? Now, can we make the non-farm sector activities still dependent on agriculture produce? Can we go for farm level processing, FEO level processing, community level processing? I had an example of a friend, farmer in Bilaspur, Chhattisgarh. He processes his food on the farm. He produces oil, extraction unit of 1 lakh rupees. I have seen some FEOs producing dal in their unit. This is all possible, either at the farmer level, if it is a production is high, large, or it is at the community level or the FEO level, we can do this. For a country like India's size, with 7 lakh villages, at least around 1 lakh FEOs are required. Can anybody, either the state government, central government, take the responsibility to promote them? You need to. This is what is actually the requirement of the minute. Friends, after retirement, we are trying to organize agri course. All agriculture science graduates, those who are lifetime experience and knowledge, whether their knowledge and experience can be used for nation building and for the farmers. We are starting Agri course Foundation for New India. We are going for process, registering now. Under this, Government of India had announced 12 themes for startups. Agriculture Grand Challenge. We have applied for 3, me and my friends. One is for private sector effort of the retired people to provide agriculture extension as a social enterprise. Substitution of insecticides and pesticides with biopesticides. And third one is aggregator model for agri tractors and equipments. And on the same platform, can we also sell agriculture inputs to the farmers? We would like you to join these movements as we proceed. Plus, to take care of the farmers' distress, instead of announcing ad hoc relief to the farmers, can we introduce a mandatory crop insurance so that this is the only mechanism through which relief can be given to the farmers, but let the premium be paid by the government of India and the state governments on an equal footing or whatever agreed proportion. Nothing beyond that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very nice. Friends, so I will summarize all the four lectures, whatever delivered by Dr. Nanda, Dr. Gupta, and all other speakers. They are basically talk about animal origin foods, agricultural origin foods, their production, quality, safety. In my opinion, what they have summarized is we are producing sufficiently, number one. But the next 10 years will be of food quality. Then only you will get better market in the price. Number one, to increase the farmer's income, he should be aware about the quality of foods, how to produce it. Second is, he has to change his commodity into a brand product. Then only he will get the good market in the price. Third is the post-harvest technology, wherein the losses, what he is doing, should be reduced so that he will get a better price of his commodity or product. Either animal origin slaughterhouse waste byproduct or agricultural waste product, that has to be changed into the product which can be utilized either in the feed of the animal or in as a biofertilizer production. So that is fourth point. And if there is a buyer, there is a quality production also. I can give you a few examples in India. Somebody talk about what we are eating. Basically, because of the lack of education up to that level, to the farmers, they are not aware about how to produce. There are multinational companies which are coming in India. Why they are coming in India? They know that there is a market. When there is a market, who are the suppliers to this multinational company? I will give you a few examples of McDonald's, Pizza Hut, Burger King, and so on. Why they are coming to India? Because there is a market. Who is supplying to these people? Their standards are globally same. What they are marketing in USA, burger, the same burger of the same quality they are marketing in India. So who is the supplier to this Burger King? It's an Indian farmer. Whether it is an animal product, whether it is an agriculture product. Means we can produce a quality food. We can produce a food of that quality which is of acceptable internationally. It is the mindset of the person whether I want to produce and if there is a buyer. 13, milk processing. Yes, we are number one. But what is the quality of milk? Number one. How much is converted into the value addition? India, what we are drinking, India will be the only country in the world who is boiling pasteurized milk. So, what we require, what not require, whether I really thank the ICI team, Radford Sir, all the EDGs. They have included everything in the syllabus. It is the industry interaction of the students, entrepreneurship. But we are not taking it in the right way. What we need as a policy members or the authority to implement education in the education system, what they have included. In the right way, which should reach first to the student, and ultimately those students will take it to the farmers. Otherwise, it is not possible, they will make it. But who is going to take it to the last end user? We are talking about the farm to fork quality. Being a tropical country, we require something. Some gaps are there, we have to identify the gaps, fill the gaps. Being a tropical country, हमारे यहाँ storage अच्छी होनी चाहिए, हमारे यहाँ transport system अच्छी होनी चाहिए. So we can produce quality, we can, we are number one in milk, we are number two, five in goat, we are number six in egg production. But the quality is does matter in next 10 years. Everybody has contributed. Thank you very much. Just I don't have much time. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. I'll take just 2 minutes. Just I found that our society is so paradoxical that we are talking about the productivity and my teacher, Dr. Nimbalkar sir, just took us to a lineage of our agriculture. So I just remembered one shloka from Bhagavad Gita that Anna Bhavati Bhutani, Parjanyat Anna Sambhava, Yajnyat Bhavati Parjanyo Yajna Karma Sambhava. महाभारत के युद्ध में भी भगवान श्री कृष्ण अर्जुन को बोलते हैं कि हमारी जो पॉपुलेशन है इसको हमें खिलाना पिलाना है तो हमें सिर्फ बारिश का पानी जमीन में कैसे उसको कंजर्व करें उसके लिए ध्यान देना चाहिए. 5000 साल पुरानी बात है, अभी भी हम उसी बात को लेके चल रहे हैं. अगर आज भी हम भगवान की बात नहीं मानेंगे तो शायद भगवान के भी नहीं बचाएगा. तो मुझे कहना है प्रोडक्टिविटी और अभी जो सेशन था उसके बारे में दैट विल हैव टू थिंक दैट water conservation activity should be linked with entrepreneurship development and it should be coupled with our education. Part of education is there, part of entrepreneurship is there, but the coupling is totally missing. That's why we are suffering the problems of productivity. So this is my earnest request to chairman to add this point in our these proceedings also. Thank you, sir.
I think the whole conclave was very, very informative and impressive. And there was no time for many speakers. We are very sorry that I am not responsible for that. So finally, conclusively that it's a very good topic that the Education Division of Trisuni University has taken. I really thank Dr. Rathod and his team, and also Trisuni University and all the students, faculty who are working day and night, I think, since last fortnight or 1 month. And all the speakers, all the delegates who have come from different parts of the country. It's a very interesting subject at a crucial time, how agriculture education content should change to solve the problems of the Indian farmers. I think I am working directly with the farmers ever since I started as a research assistant. So, Devar Lakshmi cotton, all seed is produced by farmers only, and we stopped the import of 10,000 crores extra long staple cotton coming from Egypt, Sudan, and it became net exporter. All laborers, farmers, as rightly mentioned by Nimbalkar, that he left one stage that if the cloths were to be made into Peter Brand shirts, his shirt will sell at 3,000. One kg 9 meter cloth will become 15,000. So this has to percolate in an industrial manner at the village level. I think the most problematic thing in village is the freebies given by the government, which has disturbed the labor food. And lot of people who are educated do not want to work and soil their hand. This is the most important problem. How do you address through syllabus? Probably as rightly mentioned by him, creating incubators and incubatees in the ICR system, which is there in the PPD unit in the research system, but it should come to education system in the college itself. After graduation, can you attract at least 5% BSc graduates, both girls and boys? So put together 10%, can you make them entrepreneurs on the field itself? Somebody can produce watermelon seedlings, watermelon seed itself. See, watermelon seed I am producing now, that this Syngenta company is working with me. They take 5,000 rupees per kilo and sell in the market at 50,000 rupees a kilo. See the 10 times difference whether our graduates can do it. I took a Ravi camp in one of the villages in Ranaganur. farmer was producing, knowing what is tetraploid and what is diploid, and he said he was producing triploid watermelons. But our students were not knowing. It was all theory. So there has to be content change. And if you take the success stories of the Indian farmers, I started farmer to farmer exchange program at Dharwad, and we also give PhDs to farmers. There is one Abdul Rauf, his income from agriculture is 5 crores. He has 5,000 teak trees. Where he says, Patil sahab, mujhe kuch hoga hai, to main New York hospital mein business class mein jaake treatment loga aur wapas aaunga business class mein. Ye chote mote hospital mein treatment nahi. Because he says 5,000 trees into 1 lakh each, it is 50 crores of capital in his field. So this capital building process, the root capital is not there with the small farmers. Either to conserve water or to have drip irrigation, all these things are missing links. So whether the education system in the institute itself can include in the contents to have a root capital and generate incubators so that they can make a business and take all aspects of technology to the farmers field. There is one lady in Raichur Agriculture University Vice Chancellor by name Kavita. She grows 4 or 5 types of crops under organic farming. She lost everything when she went for pomegranate, blight aa gaya, nuksan ho gaya. Then she is now growing parasite sandalwood on these fruit trees. She says, I will be multi-millionaire in just 5 years. Now 5 years have gone. Her income from 7 acres is 15 lakhs. There is another farmer, Rajshekhar, whose income from 2.5 acres is 15 lakhs. So he has 90 lime plants, 5,000 for each plant, 9 lakhs is the income. He has about 60 supporter plants, from each plant he gets about 15,000. He has coconut trees, he doesn't sell coconut, he sells it as coconut seedling. All put together 15 lakhs from 2.5 acres. So this much intelligence and integration scientists say nahi hota. We are all talking and telling theoretical model and telling. Can you include such farmers content as a business stories or a practical stories in the content itself as one of the course? Then I think wonderful transformation will be there, and they can visit also the farmer who has adopted. Likewise, whatever Changappa told, that the e-marketing are pressing to happen all this. So there is one girl, Chetty also knows, Lakshmi Lokur. She is on the job of online marketing. From Dharwar, she sells organic produce to Bangalore. From it goes by bus. So all these models we can go on integrating. Whatever the FUO is, the see anything, any institution you build in India, it gets politicized within few years. So how to avoid it? Probably institution models, which whether a university KVK can have 2 FUOs, whether it can have 1 processing unit, whether it can have 1 fertility and water storage research unit, so that you can directly link all 3 to business, which Changappa told that. And we have to have a policy for export. So otherwise, all producing and dumping here and all getting spoiled. So we can go on talking, several interventions you can put. Finally, I think we are working with the farmers directly since last 7 years. So farmer has a lot of problems, and psychologically, I think they say, jo pant wala aata hai, कुछ देता है तो आ जाइए, नहीं तो 2 बार चाय पी के वापस जाइए. सो दिस इज द स्लोगन, अदरवाइज वी आर ऑन अवर ओन. सो दे हैव सोल्ड बुलक्स, नो बुलक्स दे कैन नॉट मेंटेन, 2.5 to 3 acres दे कैन नॉट कल्टीवेट इन ड्राई लैंड. एवरी वन ऑफ देम वी ट्रेन 400 ट्रैक्टर ड्राइवर्स, नॉट इवन 4 आर अवेलेबल टू मी, ऑल हैव गॉन टू बेंगलोर एंड मुंबई. सो दिस इज द फेट. सो हाउ टू व्हाट शुड अट्रैक्ट. सो देयर आर मेनी मॉडल्स in each state, there is one or the other model is there. Whether these models, studying and editing with some like Mukhopadhyay and Kumar and others, can you make a committee and then write success stories of farmers, business models, FAO models which are successful, make films, make CD or DVD or pen drive, whatever it is, put the blocks. So that can really transform. Otherwise, routine way, probably institution won't work. If I say it is US Dharwad, I will say US Dharwad is always on the top. Whether it is 10th or 11th, still I will say my university is on the top, like that. So we created 6 institutions in Dharwa, Dr. Chetty knows. One is for seed. John, seed is exploited. That's I know, just now I told one center example and a Syngenta example. So then we have organic farming. Those who want the perfect organic farming package and practice, if at all available in the country, it is at US Dharwa. With a separate school of organic farming and then mixed farming, integrated farming, all schools are there. Finally, we have highest in a lab of biotechnology, high-tech horticulture, then high-tech nutrition and textile units, then all converged into one big building called Agribusiness Knowledge Network Center. It is a model to the country, and our turnover in the university system, both from university and other, somewhere from seed only we earn 25 crores and rest revolving fund, scientist-based production programs, 25 crores. So that means there has to be business models within the education with incubation facilities. You can put like scholarship, you can put about 10 crores for incubation. And each university, 4 or 5 students, 2 or 3 girls and 2 or 3 boys, you can put on the this thing. Let them go for tissue culture, let them go for mushroom, let them go whatever activity. There is one Morocco Foundation in Rajasthan. Anybody from Rajasthan here? Yeah, you are there.
My friend Mukesh Gupta is here.
Yeah. See, they pull the vermicompost and they are giving the sets of vermicompost, and today the turnover of that is 1000 crores. It is like a FEO only. So, and as you know that Multiplex has come out with a brand of organic fertilizer. It is in the international market, 1000 crores. Basuraj, our own student from Dharwar, has a biotechnology product. He has brought tablets of plant protection. If tablet like a bucket mein dal de, it will multiply into organism, the next day you can spray into dilution. So things are happening, but they are not in our textbook. So content revision has to be regional oriented, 30% they are given, but still. So when third deans committee was being discussed at Hyderabad, when Mehta was there, the Punjab Agriculture University director of dean said, "Mujhe to 30 credit traffic ko chahiye, aap economics wagera tum padho bola." I want 30 credits for tractors only. He is right. As Punjab and Haryana, it is only tractor. So all mechanisms of tractor. Likewise, the regional people. So if it is Karnataka, Hyderabad, seed production is the hub. So we have commercially saleable products we are also to generate in the university system. But not, let there be 15-20% people who can go to academics. But however, unless we create a hub of really, there is one Sarepati in Maharashtra, 100 acres poly house. I was the first to give him the IRI award. 100 acre poly house, and his total turnover net profit is 25 crores, and he has 10 poly houses changed from rose to a grass which is hybrid between garlic and onion. It has both the tastes. And he is sending concentrate to Japan and earning 10 crores from only 5 poly houses. So many things are available, but they are not in the contents. Balraj is here?
Yeah.
Protected cultivation, 10 acres, Israel model technology in IRI. Then he has special aggregation, then covering polythene. So from this gravitational irrigation by Syntex tank, they were able to produce about 25 to 30 tons of squash, then ash board, and make about 50 to 60,000 net profit from offering. This is not a drip irrigation high tech, this is only a gravitational irrigation. He did that model in Spice Research Center also, there intercropping, intermixing, and then we went there and studied. So there are several models, but there is nobody to pool them and put in the contents. The content is changing, has to be a continuous process to suit to the model of prom. And each university is regionally located, they can change their contents. With this background, I think we are sure, as rightly mentioned by Dr. Gupta, we can produce more food, more meat, more milk, more fruits, more nutraceuticals, more nutrients. My son is in USA as a neurosurgeon. He says, in the next generation, people will not sit on the table and eat. They will only consume tablets in the form of nutrients. That will be the lifestyle in future, because they want more time for other things, not the enjoyment like what our generation is doing. With this speed of life, I think we have to think. And content changing, I think Dr. Chetty is there, you are there, to suit to local situation with the global knowledge, global experience, Indian experience, can become major content. One or two courses can be reserved for them. Thank you very much. I thank especially Dr. Rathod Chetty. Because of Chetty only I came here, otherwise I have to go to USA after 2 days. So tomorrow also we have to spend. Now there is no work by some university, because you attracted us, we have to see your university. So thank you very much. Thanks to all.
Thank you very much, sir. I thank the chairman, co-chairman, and the rapporteurs of this technical session 3. With this, we are completing the technical sessions. We had promised in the morning that there will be some question answer session. I request Dr. Chahal sir to come on to the dais to take some questions. My request is, whatever the questions you have, first raise the questions. We take the questions, and the answers will be at the end of the question answer session. Once the answer session starts, then questions will not be entertained. If you have questions, you first, because otherwise it goes on like that. And we have a very limited time, precisely 15 minutes, not more than 15 minutes. Because the music team has already arrived, they need at least about 45 minutes to set up the stage for entertaining all of us after the days long hectic schedule whole day. So, whatever the questions are there, I will take the questions, sir. Please, if there are questions. And one more announcement I wanted to make. I request all the speakers of all the sessions to provide the write-up of 5 to 6 pages of their talk. It is not the PowerPoint presentation. Maybe you can include graphs, figures and tables, but I request them to provide the write-up of the topic on which they spoke, because the university is interested in bringing out a book on this conclave, and it is going to be useful to most of the people who are not even attending this conclave. So this I request all the speakers to spare, and I also request the chairman of each sessions to give it, you know, write up on the topic, the, you know, theme areas, of the theme area on which they were chairing the session. There are two things, sometimes the chairman and the speaker both are there, the topic is something different, and the chairman is supposed to write on the theme area. I request all of them, and maybe you can take about 2 to 3 weeks time, and you can send a soft copy either to me or to Mrinalini from Raisoni University. We will bring out in the form of a book. So this is a request, and please don't expect us to remind you time and again, so that we want to bring it as quickly as possible. Thank you very much.
Hard pressed for time, and only 15 minutes we have snatched for question answer session. And without wasting any time, I shall request one or two questions with respect to first session, that was on status and scope of human capital requirement in agriculture and allied sciences. Just one or two questions, please. Answers.
This is not a question, just a request. Because in this forums, it's just a general request that we can also involve the students. Because we talk about the agriculture education, what we are going to do after like 10 years and all that. So we are having we are discussing a scenario wherein the stakeholders are mostly the students. Whereas because I have added a few forums like this.
You straight away questions.
Okay.
No lectures. Okay. Only questions.
Yeah, it's just that we can involve the students, we can have a session with the students, what they expect out of this agriculture education or JEE, because in terms of education, we can hear from them.
We provide it to all the students in this session. I request to be very precise questions, not the lecture.
Any question to pertain to this session? More? Okay, there is no. Yes.
So in traditional university, in University of Mumbai, we experimented that one of the course